Are you looking for American-made guard equipment at affordable prices? Guard Gear UK is your one-stop shop for all your winter guard and color guard requirements. We supply a wide range of rifles, sabers, gloves, and equipment, all made by our partners in the USA. Not only that, but we also offer free shipping. That's right, free shipping to all mainland UK addresses. Why not upgrade your group today with some premium US-made guard equipment from Guard Gear UK? Find out more at www.guardgear.co.uk. Guard Gear UK is proud to be supporting the WGUK 2021 season.
Great to have Adam on board with us this evening, afternoon where he is. Super excited as General Effect is becoming one of the biggest captions of how it's evolved over the years, and it's super fast evolving. So it's great to have Adam and his expert knowledge to present, I guess, some of the key points that we can all take away regardless of class and expertise and knowledge. So yeah, no, all good. I'm excited for this, Adam. Thank you. And thank you very much for taking the time out.
Oh yeah.
Over to you, Adam.
Happy to be here. I think it's great that you guys are doing things like this too. I mean, over here, we're just kind of getting going with things like this, you know, because typically this is like our marching band time of the season. And we haven't had a whole lot of that. But I think it's great, you know, that you're putting something out there. And I started judging in 2011. And production value on the general effect sheet was still rather new then. And but about 6 years before that, when one of our WGI educational directors, Shirley Wickham, had come to me and talked about production value. And it was really her point of view of how she viewed certain designers and their programs and what she thought, why she thought they were successful. Right. And so she came to a few of us and brought up those two words, production value, in the, you know, early 2000s. And I remember saying to her, I'm thinking, tell me, what is production value? You know, what, you know, kind of wanted to hear her thoughts about that. And it was really interesting because, you know, as the years have progressed, production value, you know, as it relates to a general effect consideration, really is multifaceted. It has so many components to it. And it really allowed me, well, both as a designer and as a judge, to look at things differently, right? So when I started thinking about production value and thinking about it from a designing role, and wanted to think about all the different components of what could set up this particular group to be the best they could be, right? How we can get the biggest bang for your buck, you know, and how we could, you know, do well competitively if, let's say, our weaknesses were maybe equipment skills, right? So if our equipment skills were a little newer, you know, how could I, because my job as the designer is to make sure that there's no question about what the production value can do for the team. And just like Barry had said, regardless of classification, right? Regional A all the way up to world class, everybody has production value. And so really, you know, that's why, you know, thinking about it through the lens of production value on the general effect sheet, I thought about, you know, most of our judging sheets, and I guess you guys had conversations of what and how you talked about, you know, the judges will judge what they're doing and how they're doing it. For me, when I think of production value, it's not only on the effect sheet of what and how, but it also answers the why. So if you're watching a team, if you're watching a program and it has that depth, then it kind of goes to the next level of what it answers for the choices, why the design team made the choices they did. And if that could be answered from a why point of view, then production value really is successful and really helps to elevate those groups. So what I have is a PowerPoint, and I'll share it after we're done so you guys can have, you know, copies of it. And I just took different elements of kind of how I divide this up, you know, what I thought production value was way back when Shirley Wickham brought it to my attention, and then really thought about how is that different than a show? Like, this is my show or this is my production. And so I'll kind of walk through that. And I, you know, I still judge, and I live down here in South Florida and moved down here 4 years ago. and focused with mostly a high school group. And I thought about a video to share as we go through these points. And I guess I have to go back to a team that I taught in 2000, which 2000 sounds like it wasn't that long ago, but when I think of it as 20 years ago, I'm like, oh my God. So yeah, this is 20 years ago. And it's a group I taught in Atlanta when I first moved to Atlanta. And they were not on the WGI scene at all. It was a rather new school to WGI. They had gone to WGI the year before I moved up there. And they were in Scholastic A, and I think they had semifinals, and they were like 43rd in semifinals. They didn't make finals, but 43rd out of 100 and something. So they, for them, that was an element of success. And, I moved there a year later, and of course I wanted to take them to WGI. But when I met these kids, they had certain skills. They had certain abilities that I thought they could stand out really well. And it was my job to design and put this program together to hopefully make them really stand out. And I think when I look back at them, I think production value is what elevated them. And so they're kind of like an interesting story, because we got promoted in February that year out of A class at the Nashville Regional. And those kids had never won a regional in their life. And they played the whole promotion music, and the kids thought, that's what you do when you win a regional. It's like, no, you're being promoted to open class now. We'll see how this goes. And so the kids really had no idea what was going on, which was kind of fun. But we had no time. This is February. And so, and in fact, Shirley Doherty, a WGI judge, she had asked me, she had said, did you have to redo parts of the program? Did you have to do anything to the show to get, because they were now in open class? We didn't do anything, nothing different. We just got better, because the kids were still, their weaknesses at that time were weapon skills. We had to get better with that. And so we just kind of plugged along. We went down to Jacksonville, Florida a week after we were promoted, and we won the open class in Scholastic Open. And the kids were just, we all were just, wide-eyed and couldn't believe all of this. And then we took them up to the Dayton Regional that year. And that was, we traveled to do these regionals, and they ended up second place at that regional. And, in Dayton and the Midwest and like Indiana, there's a ton of open in World Guards. So here's this team from Atlanta now, kind of being thrown out there with the wolves. And it was mind-blowing, their whole path to get to Dayton. And I say this because I've chosen their video to kind of navigate through, because I really think that production value is the piece that got them all the way to the end in Dayton as a open class guard. I mean, they won Scholastic Open in prelims. And I was like, what is, in fact, Michael Shapiro, he had, he saw them in prelims, and he came over to me and said to me, they're going to do really well. And I said, what's really well? And he says, he thought they were going to win this thing. I'm like, no way. And they ended up, like I said, they ended up winning semifinals, and we got to finals, and they were 4/10 in second place, which the kids were ecstatic, and it was amazing. But I go back to that, all those elements of production value to really set them up. So that's kind of why I wanted to give you just a little backstory on why I chose this team here. So is it okay to share the PowerPoint now? Okay. I'm just going to click buttons here and hope this all works. All right. Okay. So do you see a PowerPoint there? Okay, good. I do that. In my real life here, my real job is not just the whole color guard thing, but I'm an elementary teacher. So right now I'm actually, I have the majority of the kids in my classroom, but we also have a virtual component too. So I'm always like trying to figure out the Zoom thing while teaching. So hopefully I'll do this pretty well here. So production value, and I kind of titled it this idea of the what and how and why of effective programming. And like I said, not just answering what the group is doing and how they're doing it in terms of achievement, but also why. If we can answer that, or if judges or audience or spectators, anybody can understand that part, I think that's where we can think about production value giving us the biggest bang for our buck. So here, you know, I thought about this when I go back to production way back when, and I thought about it. I wanted to see, well, what's the difference of the production versus a show? This is our show or this is our production. So I just put this together here as just kind of talking points of production. The act of producing, creation, a manufacture, the creation of value, the producing of articles, having exchange value. Now this, I took this off from the dictionary, but I thought about that. You know, you think about that second bullet point that made me think about flags, rifles, sabers, floor, and think about, you know, people didn't even have floors 20 something years ago, right? And now now we can print everything. So sometimes things are overproduced and then goes the other way. But, you know, I thought about that second bullet point, and it really takes in so many elements, right, of what we do in our color guard world. Production of work of literature or art, the organization and presentation of a dramatic entertainment, or the entertainment itself, and just kind of how that's different than a show. So this is kind of where it made me kind of, the light went off a little bit. Here's a show, a display, exhibition, or demonstration. Appearance, an impression, a display, exhibition, or demonstration, an indication or a trace, a sight or a spectacle. And then I just throw this out there as a question, what makes those definitions of both those words similar and different? And so for me, what makes them similar is the obvious, right? You know, both productions or shows are displays or they're presentations. What makes them very different for me, what I feel like, is the production is more layered, right? So when I just compare those definitions from one slide to the next, it feels as though when we're talking a production, it's not just any one or two or three things, it's so layered. And we take in many, many different components. And I don't, you know, now in the last 2 years, it really was a push for the upstairs judges to talk about equipment and movement. So how equipment and movement choices elevate the design analysis, right? Or how does an equipment or movement phrase create effect? Where, I don't know how a lot of you feel, I feel, you know, I'll put up the design hat on for a minute. And I say, well, of course, I want judges to talk about equipment phrases and how they created an effect, because that's what we do, right? We write equipment, we write movement, but it's refreshing to know now that really has been a push from the judging point of view, that they want those upstairs judges to talk about that and to talk about how those choices that designers have made create a variety of effects. So for me, the production piece really is more layered when we take in all those considerations that I'll share on the slide. So the first one is the concept. And so concept is a big component of production value. And I have to be honest with you, you know, the video that we'll watch, the concept is not, it's about it. I had this idea when I was in the arena the year before, and I thought, oh, how cool would it be to make our floor look like a racetrack? So it's not just like a rectangular floor you bring on the floor championships. It's a racetrack. It has a different flow to it. We can create some really cool staging. And it really started with that idea. And the concept developed with this idea of, it's more about the human element of finishing a race. It's the idea of accomplishment. It's about the last person who crosses the finish line, not the first. And this is the idea that I took to these high school kids. And we used Mozart's Requiem as the soundtrack to this, because it has such an emotional value to it that it made me feel as though we can tell this story of that last person who crossed the finish line. So for me, and these are with high school girls, right? Like, how can I get them to understand that? But I thought they were very mature, and I thought they had a good way of explaining this on their level, so they could demonstrate and they could relate that to the audience. So concept is huge as it relates to production value. And just kind of some, I'll just kind of go through some of these talking points. This the definition of concept, an idea of something formed by mentally combining all its characteristics and particulars, right? So that really, again, that made me think about, oh, this is totally color guard, right? So the concept, how can the concept be driven through various components that we can get credit for that? I think someone's trying to get in. Let's see, hang on. Yes, There we go. So I wanted to have something conceptual that took in many different ways that we can say the concept, not just with a floor, not just with a flag, but maybe the movement, right? If the movement can say what the concept is, then there's value to that. If the are the equipment choices saying that as well, then we have value and that has depth to it. So I'll go through the, some of the questions here. And I put this in question form. So as designers or as judges, that we can provide our own answer to it, right? To any one person, we have our own thinking that we can take to this. But how does the concept drive all choices made in the program? Conceptual ideas can be both literal or non-literal interpretations. So the video I'm going to share, it's very non-literal. It wasn't about an actual race and who wins the race and gold, silver, bronze. And in fact, I remember going to a critique early season that year, a local show, and it was a GE judge. And he said to me, so if your show has a race, it's about a racetrack, you have a racetrack out there, why are the kids not wearing warm-up suits? Why are the kids not wearing, you know, what he thought, shorts and tank tops? And I'm thinking, okay, that's not what this is about. And it was my, I had to explain to him, well, this is more of a non-literal approach. So I want you to maybe think of it as this. So I was prepared to explain that to him. The third talking point here, what do you want your audience to feel from your concept? How will they be involved in the process? What do you want them to take away from the experience? And I say audience, because I think that takes in the judging community, it takes in the you know, the staff, it takes in mom and dad, you know, supporters, anybody, right? I think that's important. What do you want your audience to take away from that? And that would include all. And I think through that, even I want the judges to take something away from that, you know? So that, to me, that's just really important when thinking about concept. And this is the second column here. Concept can be connected with color, props, set, equipment movement, and staging choices. And I think that's huge. And I think that, you know, it, that could answer, well, why did we stage a group a certain way at a particular moment? How does that elevate the conceptual choices? I thought about a group, the team I teach out here in South Florida, Park Vista High School, I brought them to WGI in 2018. And that was their second time going. And we had these circular floors that were opening and closing. The whole show was about breaking the silence and speaking out. And it was pretty powerful. And we chose that program. We chose our soundtrack. It was pretty edgy at times about speaking out. And the elements of the soundtrack was Somewhere in America. And it was three girls that were speaking out about really political things in our country. And it's powerful because they're high school girls speaking out. I thought this could be great. We use clips of it. But there was one part of that where they talk about gun violence. And we were very clear about how we were gonna use that and how far do we go with that. But that you know, we designed the show in what, November, December, and then February we had the shooting here at Stoneman Douglas, which is 15, 20 minutes away from us. So it became so relevant. And you know, from a concept standpoint, we really had to make sure that we were making it very relevant and real. Not that we weren't, but we had to be very attentive to that because of how close it was, you know. But I was saying that because there was a staging moment where the biggest floor had the biggest sound waves, and that was the loudest sound waves. It was the loudest part of the soundtrack in terms of all those layers, and those were staging choices that drove the concept. And I just think that was an element that was really, it was fun to be able to explore that from a design standpoint, and it was nice to be able to get credit from the judging community where they noticed and recognized that. And I just put this question here, how many ways can we say seasons? And I say that because, you know, I also taught a team way back, and they were literally a brand new high school. They couldn't do anything. They didn't have equipment skills. They were really freshmen, and they didn't come from any experience with color guard. And so talk about doing something conceptual, we had to find something they could relate to. They couldn't do this show I'm going to show you in a minute, and they couldn't do something that was so intellectual. I had to kind of work at their range, and we used that piece every season, about the four seasons, but we really made sure that it oozed production value, had this really cool concept. So we took the whole idea how seasons don't go from one to the other, that there's a blend, right? There's a transition that morphs. So color slowly changed, setting changed, staging changed. And it was really fun to do. It was a cool way for us to explore from a design point, but it also made a bunch of kids who didn't have a whole lot of skill come across pretty mature. So that was pretty cool. And that's why I say the last question is, can our performers relate to the concept? So I'm going to share the video. Hopefully, I think I have to stop share and then reshare and all that business. Okay, stop texting me. Sorry. All right, let's see here. I feel like I'm in my classroom, then I mess up and all the kids go, Mr. Sage, you didn't do it right. That's about what's about to happen here. Okay. The video, okay. All right, let's see here. Screen share. I think that's it there. Do you see a black screen? Okay. And do you see the high school name, Pope? Oh, lovely. Now let's see if you hear sound. Let me just kind of fast forward this. Can you hear sound? Oh, even better. Success. Okay, cool. So let me make that a little bigger. Okay, cool. So yeah, this particular video is of Pope High School from Atlanta. And you'll see the floor is kind of these earth tones of warm tones. I really wanted to make it feel that it had that emotional connection right away.
Pope High School Color Guard, you may begin your performance in competition.
So right when we unfolded the floor, it had that kind of that earth tone with the brown. It wasn't like your typical, like whatever color a track would be. Those were all deliberate moves. And even the color of the costuming and kind of how it went with the interior of the floor here. You'll see those three numbers on the floor. Every performer had a number as well. And those numbers were a part of the costume on the back. And so I wanted people to get this idea just from the initial setup that this is about a race. But you'll see from a movement standpoint, just from the beginning of the program, on how movement choices totally told the concept right away. And I thought that was a huge part of production value that did not go unnoticed. And that was really nice that, you know, audience could feel that and understand that. So we'll just play the first production part of the production. So just stopping right there. So I thought from the onset of the program, it wasn't just about a concept, right? You know, and saying, well, here's our idea. We had to, like I said, we had to be very deliberate of what the movement choices were. So it gave you that feeling they were warming up and getting ready for the race. And even the choice of that one rifle soloist, she was obviously like, you know, we all pick our best kids, obviously, for the first rifle toss. I mean, my kids that year, weapon was very new to them. And so this one girl, she's a rock star. But yeah, the idea was to pick the rifle off the floor. I didn't want her to do all this choreography, pick it up, let's throw that first toss. And it's like the gun sounds, the race starts, right? So that was pretty deliberate. Then you'll see this next progression here from a staging standpoint goes around the lanes of the racetrack. It's one rifle, one saber, one flag. And they have choreography that travels, but then three performers come from the interior to then get handed off that piece of equipment. It's a relay race. So that was another thing we said, okay, how can we tell this idea? How can we explore it through staging and equipment? And so this next development that I'll play the next section builds to rifle saber flag that initiates from a relay race. So we'll continue that. So just stopping there for a second. One of my favorite parts from that development, from a staging point, was not just that whole relay race. It wasn't about one idea. Then if you, I don't know if you noticed, but then equipment phrases started developing around the floor, a group of three, a group of three, a group of four, that kind of a thing. So then we were able to then consider equipment ideas, but also how, from an intellectual standpoint, from a GE point of view, how that elevated. Right. So to me also, you know, thinking about effect and how we create various effects, whether it's aesthetic, intellectual, emotional, it's really, it's the triad of all three working together. There's an emotional value. There is the intellect of how, you know, elements are brought in from a staging standpoint, which from production value, we should get credit. And then the aesthetic of just the environment, right? So that was one of my favorite ideas of how the staging accumulated. And I like to tell this story. Can you see my little arrow right here moving? Okay, this is, I like this story. I have to give a shout out to these poor girls because this was so new to them. They were so nervous. They never were in the Dayton Arena before until this show, because semifinals and prelims were like, you know, the convention center or somewhere else. And, you know, they were doing so well. And then they get to UD. And I don't know if you noticed, there's a team watching us from the end of the tunnel. That's Franklin Central. That's the team that ended up winning that we beat the first 2 days. So Franklin Central's watching us from the end of the tunnel. That made my kids pretty nervous. So anyway, there is a group right back here. There were four sabers, right? That when all these ideas were kind of crescendoing and developing, four sabers through this big toss. It was beautiful. One of the girls that day at rehearsal, a senior, got really nervous. And she said to me, and she was fine. She might have, you know, didn't have the best catch in the world at our last run through that Fantasia was watching us. And she was fine. And she said to me, she said, I don't want to throw the toss in the corner. And I'm thinking, we're about to go to WGI finals. She said, I don't want to throw that toss. I said, what's the matter? She said, I think I'm going to drop it. I said, well, let's maybe rethink our thoughts right now, you know? And so then she was like, really, she was adamant, right? And I, like I said, she's a senior. I only had been teaching the girl for like a couple of months, right? So I said to Amanda, I said, well, okay. Well, then don't throw that toss. So I said to her, when you come to that corner there, there were these props, like right here, you can see a little edge of a backdrop. They were thin, really thin backdrops, because for me, we'll get to this too in the presentation, props can either be your best friend or your biggest enemy because of transitions, right? But I had one other girl, you'll see that we always have this one girl kind of running the track as the show goes, right? As the production's developing. And it worked out well because she was pretty new in her equipment skills. So maybe she did a few things here and there. And then we asked her to run a couple laps, right? It just kind of created another layer for us. Well, I was so thankful that we had those little, you know, tall, thin walls in the end zone, because in my mind, like a football field, it's the whatever those things are called, the goalpost, the touchdown, whatever, right? I'm like, oh, there we go. That it makes sense when we looked at the set design. But it also helped us when I would have to say to Amanda the day of finals, well, maybe you just kind of tuck yourself right there in the corner and come out on that blue flag next. And thank God it worked out. But I love that story because, you know, here's this girl. It's like she never been on the WGI floor before. So hats off to Amanda. Before we move on to the next slide, are there any questions or anything like that regarding the first element of concept?
There's nothing in the chat, Adam. I don't know if anyone's got any particular questions they'd like to ask at that stage.
All right, if not, we can go on. If there's something, we can do another stop by. Can you see the PowerPoint now? Lovely. Okay, so the next slide that we'll go through is the sound design and the soundtrack. And again, and you know, for those of us who put programs together, design shows, it's really nice to know that the judging community should be recognizing how soundtrack and sound design is an element of production value and how we make those choices. We want to get credit for that. So sound design, the particular auditory effect produced by a given cause. Here are just some questions here. How can the sound design set our units up to succeed? Does it have a strong beginning and ending? Will the piece alone keep our attention the entire time? How can the sound design further enhance our concept? So for me, with this particular concept, it was, you know, the Mozart's Requiem. It's all about an emotional journey. The next part that we'll watch in a minute, the voice that comes in is a female, and her voice kind of evokes this emotion, evokes a certain feeling that also gave us the inspiration of color choices and all the various shades of blues and turquoise. And the next part of the production utilizes flag and these big, tall, 14-foot wooden poles. And for us, those were the javelins that you would see on a track. And it created a really cool scale on the floor. And it helped us kind of create some staging choices and different environments that elevated production value, but also kind of was inspired by that moment of the soundtrack. I think soundtrack is huge too, because it really has, our kids have to be able to relate to that, you know? And I have to think a lot about that with maturity of students, whether they're independent kids or high school kids, can they relate to that? And if the soundtrack alone doesn't have strong pacing, then do we have the capabilities to tweak the soundtrack? You know, have someone help us with sound design? It's just kind of knowing what your strengths are. I think back to way back when, actually, when Michael Shapiro and I started the Tarpon Springs Winterguard back in the 90s. And you know, those kids, we had somebody on the, he's still there, who designs their music. He's masterful at sound design. So we really created this great soundtrack to really help elevate these young kids, right? And so it really is kind of knowing what your resources are and so forth. But I think soundtrack is really huge in terms of the pacing and how it evolves over time. Does a soundtrack develop our production value? Does a soundtrack help us stand out and be unique? And so for that one group that I was telling you about that we did the seasons, not the most unique concept in the world, but the kids could sustain it. We also knew where our end result was. It wasn't Dayton. We brought them to Dayton 2 years later, you know, but we knew that where the end, we kind of began with the end in mind, and we knew where that was going to be. Their arena, what that all would look like. So sound design is really huge. And that piece with the Mozart's Requiem was very, at first it was very difficult. They're mature, they were mature kids. It was very difficult for them, but you know, we had to do a lot of improvisation, a lot of acting classes and things like that. So they would feel the music, you know, and they connected beautifully to it eventually. And this is a group the year before I moved there, they did The Lion King. Loud, jungle, face paint. And these are the beautiful kids. I'm thinking, oh my God. So we really had to kind of shift their thinking a whole lot.
So we have a question just on that subject. Jason's asking if he can ask if you follow a specific design structure in terms of what you would always ensure happens at certain points within your soundtrack. He always works on the basis of building to say stick to major moments. Do you work organically from start to finish? And how do you create those moments within your show? Barry talked about pacing being a word the judges use. What would good pacing look like? So there's a couple of sort of theories there.
Mm-hmm. So the question is, do you want to make sure I understand?
Yeah, the first question was just about following a specific design structure and building to major moments.
Mm-hmm.
Organic.
Yeah, I really think it depends on what the whole, you know, what the direction is, you know? I'm thinking back to the school I teach down here in 2018, John Vanderkoff did that with us, and we were constantly editing and revising and adding more. And that whole program was about, like I was saying earlier, about speaking out. So there were times the soundtrack, it was Enjoy the Silence, and we used Eric Whitaker's piece, but we added in, so there were moments you could hear a pin drop, and then there were moments that it became so layered and so loud purposely. So that was really kind of like planned from the get-go. You know what I mean? How the pacing of that soundtrack was shaped. So I really think it depends on where, what the direction is, you know? This past winter we did, and you know, of course our season was cut short, and it was our first year going to Dayton as a World Guard. But we did George Michael's They Won't Go When I Go. And the soundtrack alone is just amazing. We didn't add much to it at all. We added some sound, bell tones and wind to kind of go along with some of the ideas we had on the set design. So that soundtrack really worked on its own because it's a great piece, you know? So really that, it really depends on what the design direction is and what the focus, you know, what the elements you have to work on the floor, you know, with the set design.
Nice. And so the second point was Barry just mentioned the word pacing, really.
Yes.
And what would good pacing look like?
Well, highs and lows, a great beginning, a great middle, great end, right, to anything. And if it doesn't, that's where it's important to think about what can we do? What can we add into the soundtrack? What's our plan for that, right? Because like I said, that Eric Whitaker piece, you know, the ending will go on and on and on and on. It really, and that's his interpretation of this way this piece completed itself. But we that wouldn't work from a competitive point of view for a 5-6 minute show. So we really had to be masterful in how we were editing that soundtrack. Whereas this year, the soundtrack, it was a perfect ending, right? But really just kind of being attentive to beginning, middle, end, and how that's shaping along the way.
Brilliant. Thank you. I'm going to mute now.
And you know what? And sometimes pacing, it's okay if it's quiet. Like I, you know, one of my favorite programs is Imachi when they did the paper cranes. And you know how Imachi is, they come on the floor and we're screaming the entire time. You know, they throw anything in the air, the crowd's going nuts. But I thought that program is masterful pacing, because that soundtrack, if you just listen to that soundtrack, maybe for the first 2-3 minutes, you might go, well, this is not very exciting. But Mike Gaines and their design team is so incredible. They created visual pacing, airspace moments that were louder than the soundtrack, you know, and how they kind of created airspace. And that alone granted, yes, of course, this is an independent World Guard and masterful designers. That's why they were as good as they are, but that is visual pacing, right? With a soundtrack that at times kind of did this, but they knew what their plan was to create this. Does that make sense? So set design is another component of production value. And just so, reading this here, a collection of articles designed for use together. And this is where it was interesting when I put my judge hat on when I started judging in 2011. I started watching a lot of color guard, because before that, you know, when you're designing, you're out with your teams, you're designing for other groups, you know, you don't really get a chance to watch a whole lot of color guard. In fact, I remember teaching the Southern Knights, and I remember going to the show there, and I had all day to watch color guard because everyone shows up at the beginning of the show to watch the Rugrats, the Juniors, the A's, Oberon, right? It's an all day affair. That's not how it is in the United States, because we're rehearsing all day long, you know, we're crazy. But my favorite part, right, was watching color guard. I'll never forget this. I said this to probably Alan or somebody, because we went to the bar. You guys have a bar there. And I thought, oh my gosh, if we only had this in the United States, I would watch color guard all day long. It was awesome. But when I started judging, that's when I started watching a lot of color guard. And when you start to see set design where, you know, it's not setting up the team for success. There's props, there's backdrops, and kids are running away from us to go transition to pick up a new flag. And so, you know, this is where we have to say, well, did you create your set design to purposefully let performers leave the floor to get a new piece of equipment and then come back on? And of course, the answer would be, well, we thought maybe just going back behind the backdrop. You know, and this is, it's not really designed into the program. So set design is huge. I'll read some of the questions here. How can our set design provide the blueprint for the program? Can the set provide reference for the concept to develop? Now, of course, now we have printed, like I mentioned before, printed floors. And then you see where things are overproduced and designers are not thinking about the print on the floor, the print on the costume, and then the print on the flag. And then it just becomes overload. but I think we see success when design, set design, can reference staging, motion, or positioning of performers and how programs are put together. How can I best design my set to set the viewer up, right? So the audience member, how can we set them up to kind of easily or help navigate the flow of the program? Coordination, is the design going to read too busy and take away from the performers? Right, that's where we're thinking about coordinating color, set design, whatever the graphic image is. You know, if the floor is really super saturated, then maybe the costumes are really drained, or maybe the flags are drained, or whatnot. You know, whatever those ideas are, to really be thought out well before anybody comes on the floor, because we've seen when that does not necessarily happen. And then, you know, we were talking about this too. Even if a group doesn't have a whole lot of money, production value is not about having a lot of money. So it's knowing what your resources are, knowing what you have, or what if you have to. We were talking about this actually a couple of weeks ago with our groups here, and I don't know how it is over there, but you know, a lot of our season was cut short. And if we go back on the floor this coming winter, and whether we're gonna have some live shows down here or virtually, we have to make sure our set design reads in both components, whether it's virtual or live. And money is an issue. It's a big issue for the high schools, for students, for families. So we may have to reuse some things. So I'm already thinking about if I reuse my floor and reuse these humongous metal props that we have, you know, maybe I can just reprint the fabric that goes on there. That's kind of inexpensive. And then the kids can get a new costume. So it's not just about having, you know, it's knowing what your resources are and how to work around that and work with that. The last column here, how can this set enhance the concept and highlight the individuals, bringing the concept ideas to life? Flats, backdrops, and props, are they properly planned in the production? It just can't be about putting along the back sideline because it looks cool and we have to get new flags. And you know, one of my favorite parts of the program that we're watching, when they start moving to the new piece of equipment, the whole staging idea evolved to the four, you know, sides of the floor. The staging brought us there, and then we were able to accumulate the next idea. And you'll see as they go to ensemble flag, the staging was really seamless and how the other performers had a pickup flag. So we really wanted to, you know, make sure that that's an important element, not to go unnoticed, and also to be sure it was designed properly. Last two questions here. Do they provide emphasis and clarity? Props, that is. Are they distracting? How can props enhance the production value in its totality? So now I will go back to the video. Hopefully this will work. Do you see video? We good? Awesome. Okay. So like you see here, you know, I knew I had to have something out here with a set design, like I was telling you about these backdrops in the end zone, but it made sense because, like I said, in my mind, they were the goalposts, and it didn't take away from anything and allowed things to appear and disappear. So we'll watch this next section. So that section there, you may have noticed, like with the javelins, like with the way they were placed down and the whole floor accumulated really quick with color and the dissolve out of that, you know, where we kind of brought them horizontally across the stage to deposit flag and then kind of rebuild the energy of this next section. That was all, you know, I think the set design allowed us to do that. And it was very, I think it highlighted our strengths a little bit, and then we could kind of hide some things, but the design I think is paramount. It wasn't like, you know, we couldn't use people because they weren't skilled enough. So therefore they just run away. You know, everything had a very purposeful transition.
Adam, there's a couple of comments in there. Sorry to interrupt you. Don't want to interrupt your flow. How much does your success rely on a shared understanding of the conceptual values by the judges or audience? How much discussion needs to happen in critique to ensure your ideas are appreciated?
None. No, I think the biggest proof are the kids or the performers in the design. Like, for example, when these kids were early season struggling a little bit with their skills, right? They just weren't as, you know, refined. I got worried and I was thinking, because I was a little, I kind of teeter-tottered in December if these kids were going to, are they really A-class kids? But when I told the kids, I did tell them in December, I think we're gonna put you in Scholastic Open. And they looked at me like I was crazy. And they said, well, they didn't understand. And one girl said, we were 43rd in Scholastic A last year. Why would we go to Open? And my answer was never, cause you know how some designers decide to go up a class cause they can probably make finals better cause there's less teams there. We hear that a lot here. That was far from my answer. It was nothing about that. I said, I think you all are skilled enough. I think you're mature enough. And I think the program is going to elevate you and you're gonna stand out. And I think you're gonna wear it well. It was tough. I remember even a few weeks later before our winter break in December, I was teaching flag work, that probably part of that blue flag feature. And, you know, one girl was just, she kind of broke down. She couldn't get something. She started crying. And I'm thinking, what is, you know, and I had to pull the kids in and kind of take their temperature and go, what's going on here? And I could tell it was like walking on eggshells. They didn't want, these particular kids, they were perfectionists. They didn't want to make a mistake. It's a very driven area. The school is academically very high. They're in the backyard of Lassiter High School and Walton High School in Atlanta. It's like the schools are so close and it's a very a good area. Well, these girls were thinking, I can't get this and I'm not good enough. And one girl said, we're going to be an open class and I can't do this. And then I looked at the kids. And I said, okay, let's forget about the class for a minute and let's trust what you can do. And this, I'll never forget this. A high school girl said this to me. She said, well, what happens if we let the audience down? And I have never in my life had a student ever say that. We don't want to let the audience down. And I said, okay, we are going to stay in Scholastic A. I don't want anyone to worry about it and forget about anything else. And the rest is history. Then we get promoted in February. I'm like, oh, great. But I say that because they were a little rocky that week getting into the first regional, really inconsistent. And I made a joke to one of the staff members. I'm like, well, thank goodness we're in Scholastic A because the kids are so inconsistent right now. And we were like talking after practice and, you know, whatever we do as instructors. And so then they show up to the practice in Nashville, you know, the day of prelims, and the kids were amazing. We all know how kids are. All of a sudden they put their like Superman suit on and their focus. And I could not believe it. Their maturity totally stepped it up. And we went in and we watched some of the teams in Scholastic A, like round one, round two, we were in round three. And I remember thinking to myself, oh, we're not going to last here. The judges in critique, they said to me, the halfway through the program, we thought we were in the wrong class. I remember Nola Jones, I'll never forget it, and Beverly Brahan, they were like, wait a second, we're in Scholastic A right now? We're not in open class? They thought the parent, we already had the shift. You know, so we were promoted that day. And I say that because I don't think, we don't have to explain, you know, maybe a little bit of explaining here and there in a critique setting. I had to explain to the GE judge, well, it's my choice. I don't want the kids to wear warm-up suits. That's not what I'm doing. You know, but I think strong design through performers to bring it to life is crucial. They are the ones that really do the talking.
That's really excellent. Thank you. Sure. A couple of people, Rick thought that section was stunning, and Jason loves the color palette. So here you go.
Thank you. So I think we'll go back to the next slide here. And after set design, the next one is color, costumes, props. Oh, thank you for that segue about colors. So, and I think, you know, I don't know how you all feel, but I think, you know, I want to hear upstairs judges talk about color, not just effect, but even from a DA point of view, how does color, those choices, not how it creates an effect, how it adds to the composition. I think that's very important. We were very clear about that with Park Vista a couple of years ago. Not only did the sound waves diminish by the end, color diminished. We went to those clear flags printed with black and gray sound waves, and everything was closing. The floors folded in half, went back to black. Everything dissolved to black on the floor in the arena. We rolled the flags up. All color was gone. That was the idea of becoming more silent by the end. And then we let the kids speak out. The kids were actually speaking out at the end of the program. But it was so refreshing to hear how color was talked about from a DA and a GE point of view. And I also think, you know, I kind of purposely put colors, costume, and props at the end, because I think the other components of production value, sometimes we don't hear enough, right? And having judges talk about soundtrack or staging or equipment and movement choices, and how that helps the production. I remember I had Crown Guard in Independent World in 2010, and we did this whole idea. First time ever I saw your face, Roberta Flack, but we twisted it with another version, and our idea was past and present. The Roberta Flack is very past. It's nostalgic. It's a memory. And that was the whole idea on the floor. It had a young couple and the memory of two elderly folks leaving one another. And it really was about that. It was about time. And there was one part about the soundtrack, and the kids even had parts of the costume unzipped and silver sequins kind of glimmered for the girls and the boys on their cummerbund. It was also purposeful, and it would drive me crazy why sometimes a GE judge would not talk about that. You know, that's aesthetic, that's intellectual, that's emotional. And there was one part in the soundtrack where we layered in A Kiss Is But a Kiss. And it was layered in, and it was the whole idea of, you know, remembering our last time together. And I remember, thank goodness, Paul Lampkin brought it up at a GE critique, and I was like, oh, thank God. You know, that was so important to hear that. And I think that, you know, judging, that was in 2010. So judging with WGI, it's been really nice to hear judges kind of dig into that more. So yeah, I put colors, costumes, props towards the end. But here we see how these elements can support, enhance the program and the identity of the guard. The coordination and complementation of elements makes for a successful production. And I think that's, you know, I think that's kind of really helps elevate when we think about how that can, you know, shape the production over time. And then the last one here, just, you know, and you can read this on your own, but how colors, thinking about flags, costumes, props, and floor, how they all work together, right? And there's a harmony on all of those elements. And I don't know how that is for you guys, but, you know, seriously, with the whole print world, like people go crazy with printing. And things are, everything's printed. And I don't know if sometimes they think, oh, wait a minute, how my flags now look with my floor or the costumes, right? So those are really important elements to think through in terms of production value. As we watch the last part of the video, it's hard to see on the video, but the last palette of flags are earth tone. They're like kind of like a taupey color of the flags. And then each performer had a painted number on their flag to correspond to the number on their back. And you can't really see on the video, but it was all very, the idea, I wanted the color to kind of fade away so we can get prepared for the very end for that last girl and that feeling of completing the race. So I'll go back and we can finish that and see how that concludes itself.
Ladies and gentlemen, Color Guard from Marietta, Georgia.
Talk about an ending that we must have played around with so many different ways to end that program. But so hopefully that kind of just, you know, like I said, I could have, there's a few other groups I've taught since then, but there's something about that whole element of those performers, those students, and their strengths of where they were then. And I thought the production value really kind of elevated them and hopefully hid some of our weaknesses. We were in world class the next 2 years that I was with that team. And by the second year, they were different people. They were different performers and they ended up third in Scholastic World that year, which as you all know, you can't compete against, you know, James Logan and Beyer High School that easily. But those kids became rock stars. They figured it out, you know? So it's really interesting, you know, when I think about production value, and I'm thinking, oh, I think that program had a lot of that. But I'll go back to the last part here. So just when I think about production value, like I said earlier, it's, you know, every sheet is what and how, but I think our GE sheet with production value also has why. And this is where the what, the repertoire of effect can really communicate. It allows the how performers to fully engage their audience through communication. It tells the why of design. The choices are made, are clear, concise, and effective. And I think maybe that answers that question. I think that's where if it's strong enough, we don't have to do a whole lot of talking when we go to critique the performers. It's in them to then bring that to the table. We were talking earlier too. This is such a strange time as we're getting ready for winter season and what it's going to look like. I mean, I haven't seen my kids since March 13th. Not at all. And the other coast of Florida, the West Coast, they've seen their kids. They're doing marching band, and some groups in Texas. California has not seen their kids. And so I don't even know what that's going to look like for us, but I know, of course, wanting to have that opportunity. We all want the opportunity to create and put that together for kids. And it's going to be a whole new way to navigate things. But I think I really do feel like production value is the non-negotiable. Regional A, all the way through world class. It doesn't mean they have to have a lot of money. It means how thoughtful and creative can we be with the elements that we have.
And there's still a little bit of a theme about the subtlety and let me get back to it. How to present subtle effects and ensure the judge recognises this. Moving on from that, perhaps, and you've just brought up the virtual situation that we will certainly as a membership be facing. So if those challenges are live in a face-to-face scenario, obviously, I suspect they'll be greater in a virtual scenario. Are there any sort of hints, tips from a design perspective or a judge's perspective as to how people could negotiate those?
Right. I think that's all going to be on staging, right? I don't even know how that's going to read, and how we have to show something virtually. But thinking about it now, it's like we have to really make sure things are staged a certain way or elements are so clear and concise. And simplistic. And even from a staging standpoint, I remember one year doing some staging with a team with Mike Gaines, and he always kept telling me, keep it simple, keep it simple, keep it simple. And so, I learned so much from him way back in the early 2000s when we were teaching Cavaliers together, and then we started doing Winterguard together. But even now, keeping it simple, keeping it clear, if we are doing something primarily virtual, that it has to be seen, right? It has to be seen from that setting, from a computer. So I think I really have a lot of that will have to do with how things are read from a staging point of view.
Great, thank you. Is anyone else have any questions on that? Let's open it up to the floor. We've got people with us from judging, from designers, performers. Does anyone have any questions for Adam? Comments, observations?
I can throw one in, Sharon.
Oh, hello, Ivan.
Hi, yeah. In the whole sort of concept of putting the show together, you sort of touched early on about the concept of some of the lesser guards, perhaps newer guards, not having the equipment skills. How much at the back of your mind do you have that as you put these productions together? Do you think, right, I better make sure I put some rifles here, some sabers, some flags there at any point during the design? Because ultimately, you could take all three elements out and just put on a stage show and right. sing, and dance, and do wonderful things, and right. actually get the best GE show of the day. Yeah. But obviously, you've got that sort of, not I guess, restriction where you've got to bring the elements in.
Right.
How do you sort of consider that as you put your sort of concept together?
Yeah, that's a great question. I remember starting that program that year, and we knew we were going to Dayton. We knew we were going to bring the kids to World Championships. And I was a little apprehensive in the beginning of that season because I knew the criteria for A-class was shifting potentially. And I remember I wanted there to be multiple layers. I knew we had to do all three pieces of equipment. I knew the kids could do it adequately. So that was something that was very much taken into consideration. But you'll notice Saber was this much. And the kids are more skilled on their rifles. So we had to then think about how can I present the saber and I'm going to mix them with rifles. There were some sabers mixed with rifles and create multiple layers to give it its presence in the design, but didn't have to highly, you know, put that risk out there for the kids. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I think it really, I think that is a huge part. In Scholastic A, though, seriously, and this is why I didn't think those kids were Scholastic A. We shouldn't be seeing all these massive layers in Scholastic A. We should be seeing a couple of voices that are done well and perform well, and the kids have those skills. That's Scholastic A. I remember judging Scholastic A a couple of years, 2018 actually, and the team that won Scholastic A, they were, I don't know how they passed not getting promoted. They were amazing. Those kids were so open class. It was unbelievable. They had multiple layers. They had all the time. So I really think choosing programs to really think about what the performer's skill set and their maturity is really crucial. And if they can't do all three, then we're going to put one down and we're going to bump up the production value so we can look so fancy you can't even see straight. You know, I mean, it's so true. It's like, were we that thoughtful? Because sometimes that's where design is not really, you know. And the group that actually won that year against us, Franklin Central, they were all about rifle tosses. If they could throw one more left-hand toss, they would. And I'm not, you know, taking that away from them. That they were ridiculously great at it. In fact, at the Mideast Regional that year, Michael Shapiro was there, and he saw them before. I had not seen them. And he said to me, Adam, you watch them here from the front row with me. Don't go up there and watch them. And I said, why? He said, they're really great on their equipment. You'll appreciate them down here. When you go up there, they're not going to have the richness of what the upstairs does, what your high school kids do. And I remember watching Franklin Central on that second row with him right up front. I'm like, oh my God, these kids are going to eat my kids. They're ridiculous. They were ridiculous on their weapons. My kids couldn't do that. But you know what? It didn't matter. We really had to find our strengths and go with it.
That's certainly a key, isn't it? Play to your strengths.
For sure.
Was that how the captions rolled down in the end as well?
I don't know. I'd have to go back and look at that. Oh, I like that question.
We'll all want to know now.
Yeah, I'm a numbers geek, so.
Me too. Where were those 0.4 of a point? Who was that? But you're probably right. It probably was equipment. You know, you're probably right.
Excellent. Any more?
Yeah, just well, I have a question. We were talking about production value in terms of color. And in essence, when we're designing and when the judges are judging, most color is presented from a silk at most times, and that's the one. However, we tend to make that our priority. But what would your suggestion be, Adam, in terms of, I guess, as a judge to recognize other color palettes within the show as they're building or not building, and as designers to ensure that the colors reflect maybe the mood changes within the performance and the aesthetics and the intellectuals, if that question makes sense. I've just kind of bunched a whole lot of questions together.
Well, I think, you know, sometimes that's the team. If a team is really successful at that, they just don't rely on flags. They rely on the whole story to tell, the color story, costumes, flags, floor, props, all of that. Those are the ones that are going to be on top, right? I remember sitting in a critique once talking about this. I would never say this, but, you know, it was just not thoughtful, the color palette. To flags, to Florida, all of that. And that was their vulnerability. It became such a competitive liability that this, you know what I mean? These other groups around them were so smart about that, you know? So I think that's why I think in terms of production, but when we can think about color in all facets, I think that's so, so important.
No, I completely agree. That's something that we ask. You mentioned about printed floors, and in the UK, that's something we're slightly tapping into just because of the financials of printing and shipping and so forth, and that'll probably change in the future. So we're quite still, I guess, stuck to painting our own floors or plain canvases as well. So that can sometimes, those choices can be taken away from us from a design because of the financials and the project around that and how to, but so that, I guess my question would be, how would, what I guess suggestion would you use in terms of designing the tarp and how we would use the tarp for color and the structure within the design element for effect without the printed?
Right. I don't know. You know what? One of my favorite programs, I think it was Clovis High School years ago, and they did Somewhere Over the Rainbow, and their floor was white with black lines everywhere, right? All these arcs and angles. And it was so clever because that was, didn't Jay Murphy stage that program? And so the kids would line up in certain points of the program, their rainbow and these arches and pathways that created the story. And there was nothing to it in terms of a printed floor, you know what I mean? I think it's really just knowing what, again, strengths are. I remember Avon High School, the balance show, and there was a tan, that's when WGI had a tan floor. So they had a tan floor with a black diagonal. And I remember Keith Potter was telling me, he's like, we were toying around with what to do. Everybody can do so much. You can print this, you can paint that, you can do it. We're gonna go with a black diagonal, there you go. And then it became, you know what I mean? It was masterful. It's just kind of knowing what, where your goals are, right? Yeah, I think that's really important. I was telling this to, when I taught over in CGN with the Pride, and I was telling, because you guys have to cut your floor in pieces and pack them up and put them in the suitcase and travel to WGI, and I'd be throwing up that things got lost. I think didn't that happen for Mayflower? Equipment didn't show up? Because I saw Michael at rehearsal and he was like gangrene and he was like, you know, going to kill himself. But I said to them, why don't we do floor parts? If you're going to cut the floor, let's do a bunch of circles everywhere. And that's our show. And you can just fold up and carry on. You don't have to use all that duct tape.
We'd be without duct tape.
You love our duct tape. Or just have a floor made of duct tape. There we go.
That's right. Oh, brilliant. Okie doke, we've got time for one or two more questions if we have them.
All right, another one, Sharon, if I could.
Oh, Ivan, you're getting your money's worth tonight.
I know. Adam, as a top designer, do you have a vision every year to actually ultimately try and achieve the hell from the performer outdoing or matching your what score?
Say that one more time. Is that
As a designer, I'm going to sort of embarrass you now and say a top designer. Am I right in thinking maybe each year you have a vision where you ultimately want your HAL performers to at least match your what score or even outdo it slightly? And if that happens, you feel like you succeeded. If you don't, maybe it's been perhaps over-designed, over-produced.
Right. I've had my fair share of realizing that, I remember when I first started designing, I didn't know what I was doing. And the kids could not relate or, you know, to it. But I guess to answer that, I'm way okay. If by the end the kids end up above the design and it works in our benefit, we'll take the points anywhere you
want. No, that's what I was alluding to. That's almost like, were you hoping that happens in a way? Yeah.
Well, no, my ultimate hope is that it's kind of even, that we all arrive. All right, maybe I secretly hope that sometimes the design is always a pinch, but I'll take 2008 DCI when I taught Phantom Regiment. That's how that Spartacus show, never, you know, that whole DCI, it was Blue Devils. And, you know, it was almost every performance subcaption was above the design. And if I was judging, I would say, oh, you are so right about that. Those kids were ridiculous. Those, as from a performance standpoint, they were undeniable, and you had to reward the kids, right? So we won DCI from that. So I'm good with that.
That is also what tends to happen with iMarchi as well. When they come over, they pretty much every caption every year, they tend to outperform their design book. It's because of the kids. The kids are phenomenal.
Phenomenal. And they still get like this bad rap about like equipment, the baton thing. It's like, really? Like, you know, the equipment judges don't know what, oh, it's under, you know, I'm like, I won't go there. Cause they're, it's like, you try that. So yeah, I think however, if you know what where the strengths are by the end, I think that could be okay.
Yeah, really helpful. Anything else before we move to wrap up? Speak now. Okay. Well, we're heading to sort of 25 past eight. So thank you, Adam. That was a really great walk through GE. I'm sure everybody's got ideas buzzing now. And I feel like I just want to go away and watch a load more shows and get inspired. Jason's sending a big thank you on the chat. I'm sure everybody will have lots to say.
Once again, just to add in that if you've got questions you don't want to ask them here, then send them into education@wguk.org. They can send them, or UK, they can send them to Adam as well, and we can get answers, etc. If there's a question that you're burning to ask, but you just don't want to say it in front of 20 other people.
Sure. Or maybe it comes to you later on, you're like, well, what was he talking about?
Yeah. And I guess I'll add to that, that if there's any sort of feedback on the bits that worked for you tonight, or the bits that you'd like to have expanded on, or, you know, do feedback to us. And so we can always look at another session, sort of drilling down into a bit more detail if that's required by anybody. So does any chaps, do you want to close up at all? You'd like to join us, or shall we wrap the evening?
I was going to say to you really quick, I think it's awesome that you guys are doing this, because I mean, like I said, I did one thing similar to with another circuit in the Midwest, but there's not a lot of it, you know. And I think it's amazing that you guys are doing this, and especially in a really, really tough time right now, and so finding new ways to do this and to still give kids opportunity.
Yeah. I think everyone's really benefiting from them. We've had three amazing sessions now, and I'm really looking forward to the remainder and building on it going forward. So, but thanking everybody as well for joining in, and do encourage others on your staff teams to get involved, because I think, you know, the better the discussion, the more questions we have, everybody learns from everybody else. And that's kind of, particularly at this time, the way forward. So thank you all for joining in tonight. Alan, Mark, anything from you?
Just to say a huge thank you to Adam. Fantastic session. Thank you to everybody for attending tonight. It's really, really good. I totally echo what Adam said. For us, it's about building our community and strengthening our colour guard circuit. So the more that we can do, the better. So thank you very much, sir. It was really well worth tonight.
And this is also, this is the time that we never have a chance to do this. So I know we have less responsibilities in the sports hall right now. So this is a great time for us to learn and, you know, get our master's degree before we go back.
Brilliant. Oh, somebody else wants a bit of paper.
And
do a patch.
And Adam will be sharing the presentation that we'll post on the community group, and Alan's quite quick at posting the recording as well. So we'll get that out to everyone for you to share with your staff groups and those that couldn't attend this evening. But yeah, thank you, Adam. Thank you for your dedication. You were the first of our expert panel. hopefully the pressure wasn't too much, but I think, as Sharon and everyone else said, like, it was a great session, and like, honestly, it's amazing. It's very insightful, and everything like this really helps us here in the UK.
Sure.
And hopefully it's something that we can repeat in the future as we're building our community, which is our phrase, and that we're working for. So thank you.
Yeah, fabulous. Thank you.
This presentation is part of the WGUK Virtual Education Programme and has been brought to you in association with Guard Gear UK, the only official European distributor of Design by King products.